teacher pay, and reduce class sizes, and care about and nurture Carolina's first children health insurance initiative. After being elected Attorney General in 2000, Governor Cooper protected North Carolina families for four consecutive terms. He oversaw a sharp decrease in crime and fought for consumers by advocating for lower utility rates and putting predatory lenders out of business. As North Carolina's 75th governor, Governor Cooper is ready to make lasting investments in our future. He wants to ensure that North Carolinians are healthier, better educated, and more prosperous for generations to come. Governor Cooper is also committed to ensuring that state government looks like the people it represents. And according to the Raleigh News and Observer, he has appointed the most diverse cabinet in North Carolina history. Governor Cooper has stated that he understands the challenges facing our North Carolina families and communities, and wants to build a North Carolina that works for everyone. We are looking forward to working with our new education governor and are hopeful for the future of North Carolina public schools with him at the helm. I present to you the Honorable Roy Cooper.
Each of you should be getting a standing ovation. Kathy, thank you so much for that kind introduction. Thank you, educators, for what you do for our kids, what you do for our economy. And thank you for coming together to this gathering to make yourselves even better educators. I appreciate that. I want to say that I have three daughters, Kristen and I have three daughters. Middle school is probably about the toughest time. As you well know, with kids going through changes and with kids figuring out where they're going with their life. And you are so critical in their development. And coming together with common goals, coming together with your experiences that each of you have as middle school educators can make you all better and make us more effective. I am so grateful to the state of North Carolina and to my people for my public school education. And it was all the way from first grade through law school. I'm grateful that I had the opportunity. I'm grateful that my three daughters had the benefit of public education. And I am so grateful for my mom, who was a public school teacher. She taught school in middle school some, but mostly in high school. And I'll never forget how hard she worked and how committed she was to her profession. My mom would have been teaching school for years, and she'd be working on this lesson plans. And I said, Mom, you've been teaching this class for a long time. Why are you having to do that? She said, because things change, and students change. And we have to be on the forefront every time. I saw how hard she worked. I saw that she brought further work home. And I know you educators out there are doing the very same thing, and I thank you. You know, North Carolina has for decades been a special state in that education not only has been in our state constitution, it's in our DNA as North Carolinians. And I think most all of us can agree that since the recession, we have not made investments in education that we should have. first in teacher pay doesn't cut it in North Carolina. 50th, 49th, 50th were the bottom in assistant principal and principal pay in North Carolina doesn't cut it. We have to do better. And not only do we have to do better with educator salaries, we have to do better with investments in our education in a broad spectrum of early childhood all the way through K through 12, our community colleges, and our universities. We're at a critical point for our state. The good thing is that you probably know about the budget that I have presented, where we have raised no taxes, we have raised no fees, we have dipped into special funds, and we have cut services. But we have made a significant investment in our people and in education. I want North Carolina to be one of the top 10 educated states in our country. We have to do that. We have to make certain that our kids have the education that they need for the future. Clearly, attracting and retaining the best teachers is an important part of that. I have put forth a budget that would, over the next 2 years, give an average of a 10% pay raise to all teachers throughout our system. And today we released the proposed salary schedule where every single teacher in every step gets a pay raise. And it gives an average of 5% each year, and the steps range from 3 to 7%. One thing I know is that there have been some efforts to increase pay for starting teachers over the last few years, but our veteran teachers often have been excluded. And it is important that we guide all of our teachers and that we work to attract and retain the best. One of the saddest things to me is talking to an educator, and I go to a lot of schools and I take time to speak with teachers, I take time to speak with teacher assistants and assistant principals and principals. And I talk to someone who loves education and loves their profession, but they discourage their own children from going into the profession. And we're seeing that reflected in the reduced number of admissions to our schools of education throughout our state. That has to change. We have to make teaching the respected profession that it is. We need state government to recognize the work that you do, to tell this positive story about the lives of change and kids that you get ready to send to high school and then out into maybe higher education or the world of work. We need to tell that story. And you need elected officials who are going to tell a positive story and who are going to encourage that we invest in education. My plan would make us number one in Southeast in teacher salaries in 3 years. And within 5 years, it would bring us to the national average. That's something that we have to do. We also have to invest in our assistant principals and principals. We know that good school leaders are important. We've fallen behind. My budget provides for an average of 6.5% grade school principals and assistant principals in order to make sure that we attract the very best there. I've also recommended what used to be called Teaching Fellows Scholarship, now the Best and Brightest Scholarship. And it makes so much sense that we try to attract the best. best and brightest into the teaching profession. I remember doing the Teacher Fellow Scholarship interviews when they first started, and I looked at the stack of nominations and the people we were about to interview, and I said, we're getting the top of the class. We're getting the best kids who are worthy to teach in our public schools the next 4 years. Now, I know there's been some controversy about this in General Assembly, but I want to work with them on how we can reshape these scholarships to make sure that we now are raising up the profession of education and are attracting the very best and brightest. And we can't ignore either the fact that often, particularly by the time they get to middle school, you're getting kids in various states of readiness. Each kid learns at his or her own pace. You may have kids speaking a second language. You may have kids with disabilities. You may have kids who just didn't get started like everybody else did. And I talk particularly to our elementary school teachers about the need for investing in early childhood. The budget that I propose eliminates the waiting list in 2 years for pre-K education. It invests even more in Smart Start and early childhood education, and it gives families and people with children and dependents that child care dependent tax credit that was taken away before. Because when we have working families, they need to make sure that their kids are in a place where they're learning, where they're getting ready to be, to enter school, so that they have the opportunities that many other kids have. And I think it's important for us to make sure that we make that investment. You know, we leave our kids with you often more hours in the day than we as parents see them away. We trust the men and women who are standing in front of that classroom with our kids. We trust them to help mold them into future leaders, to successful people. We trust you. I think it's time to put our money where our trust is. I think it's time to make sure that we properly invest in public education. Now, you ask, how can I help? Well, clearly this is a budget that has to go through the General Assembly. And I know that I have some high-profile disagreements with the Republican leadership in the North Carolina legislature. You know, some things we're just going to disagree on, and we're going to continue standing for what we believe is right, fighting for what we believe is right. But I've also been talking with them, and I think people, even though we are more politically polarized than we've ever been, both as a state and as a country, I think people yearn for leaders who will say, okay, I know all the political rhetoric is going on, but it's time to sit down, roll up our sleeves, start listening to each other, and say, where can we agree? Where can we agree? How can we achieve consensus? Public education has got to be one of those ways. And I was heartened to see Republican leadership talking about, no, we haven't, can't do more for teachers. And I say, great, that would be great. If we have a contest who could do the most, I think that would be a positive contest at the end of the day. So we need you to let your representatives and senators know the importance of investment in education. You need to let your parents know, people in the community, because this is a critical moment. There's also going to be a critical moment about how we're going to pay for this. The good thing is that I think our economy is improving since the recession. A lot of people are still struggling and still trying to make ends meet. The tax revenue has increased. The question is, how are we going to invest that tax revenue? Are we going to do more corporate taxes, or we can give more tax revenue away to the wealthy and those who are already doing well? Or are we going to invest that money in public education and middle-class tax cuts? That's the question, and that will be the fight. I talked to a lot of CEOs in recruiting businesses, and I'll talk to them and the kinds of businesses that we want, the kind of jobs that we want. The first question they ask me is, when they're looking at North Carolina, not what is your corporate tax? They ask me, do you have the people who can perform the jobs that I create? Do you have that well-trained workforce? Do you have people who can think critically and can do the job? That's what businesses are looking for. That's how we grow our economy, is to make sure our kids are educated. People often ask me, what do you want out of me, Governor? What do you want out of me? And I tell them just what I've told everyone who are his cabinet secretaries, who are hired to be in the governor's office. I said, what I want at the end of the day, and I want you to work toward this, to keep your eye on this every single day. I want in North Carolina where people are better educated, they're healthier, and they have more money in their pockets. And they have the opportunity to live a more abundant and purposeful life. That's what I want. And state government needs to know when to help and when to stay out of the way. But when it helps, it needs to fulfill its responsibility under that state constitution to make sure that we properly fund public education and that we get value from it for our kids. There are a lot of issues that we can discuss. I know that the issues of assessments and accountability and how we measure that are issues that can often be complicated. I know that often you have to deal with the latest directive from Rob and how frustrating that can be sometimes. I think it's important to have state leaders who will listen to you, will listen to what is happening on the ground, in the classroom, what is the best way to assess it. Most teachers I talk to understand that we have to demand performance and that we have to assess performance. The issue always is how do we do it and how do we do it in a fair way. And listening to educators tell us how to do that is so important. I want to tell you that I am committed to public schools. I don't think we need to be siphoning off money from public schools to private school vouchers. I don't think that. To do is to use our precious tax resources to make sure we fully fund public education. There are a lot of choices we're going to have to make. There are a lot of priorities that we're going to have to make sure that we put in place. But when I talk about priorities, a lot of people can talk about it. But what I tell people is show me your budget. That will show what you have. And I think that if you look at our budget, which we call it Common Ground Solutions, I think we can find common ground in education. And I think that education is a solution to a better North Carolina and a North Carolina that is moving forward. I'm grateful for your support, grateful for the fact that you are here, and let's keep working hard to move North Carolina forward. Thank you so much.
Outline your teacher pay scale that you announced today.
Yeah, I can get you a copy of it because we just released it today, but it's important to note that it provides pay raises across the board. The last couple of raises that the state government has passed is concentrated in a particular area like starting teachers, and talked to some veteran teachers who got no pay raise, and some of them even got less money than they did before because of the way the salary schedule worked out. we thought it was important to make sure that we spread those raises across, because our veteran teachers are valuable as well. And the steps, I believe this is right, they're no less than 3% and no greater than 7% for an average of 5% across this year and then another 5% next year.
Governor Cooper, when it comes to your budget, specifically with education, what aspects, what components do you feel like are pieces that can be agreed upon and that the House and Senate can build upon?
I think the Republican leadership in the legislature has clearly staked out that they want to raise teacher salaries. I think that that is important, and I'm glad of that. And I'm hoping that we can find a way to reach agreement. Another area that gives me hope is early childhood. A number of CEOs from across our state, prominent CEOs, have come forward with studies showing that this makes a real difference in kids being ready to learn with pre-K and child care early in a kid's life. So that combined with our child care tax credit, we think will help that. So I'm hopeful for that as well. And I am hopeful for our community college and university funding as well. But the good thing is that there is more available money for investments. The real crucial test is going to be how that money is invested. And I believe that public education needs, all the way from early childhood to universities, needs to be the focal point of it.